There's a second Emily, Emily Volker, who is going to take us back to Paris. Emily has her PhD from Boston University in art history and architectural history. She's a photographic historian, and she's working just now under a postdoctoral fellowship from the Smithsonian Institution. And then when that's completed, she's going to embark on a similar one for the Crystal Bridges Museum. So she's going to be a busy lady here over the next few days and years and months or whatever. She's going to talk about photographic images taken by Prince Roland Bonaparte in Paris of the Ogallala Sioux who were represented during the 1889, is that correct? Exposition. And so we're looking forward to that and see if these 89 Indians are really better looking than the 87 ones. Thanks.
So thank you so much to everyone at the papers and the center for having me. It's just wonderful to be back. I did some research here on a fellowship for my dissertation, and it was a truly wonderful experience. So it's just great to be back. During Buffalo Bill's Wild West stay in Paris for the 1889 Exposition Universelle, Prince Roland Bonaparte, grandnephew of Napoleon I and a member of French scientific circles, visited the troupe on multiple occasions and completed a photographic series based upon his encounters. Comprised of 148 albumen prints alternating frontal and profile views of the featured sitters, the body of work fills three luxury albums and focuses primarily on the Lakota performers. These pictures of indigenous showmen, and in a few instances, women, register a range of emotions and modes of self-presentation from the exchanges that occurred during the image-making process. This spectrum includes the more dapper and proud self-possession of Kill's enemy, who you see here, who confronts the camera with a slight smile on his face and head held upright in the frontal view, and right arm lifted upward with blanket slung over his left side in the profile. In contrast, Featherman appears with a solemn, withdrawn, nearly vacant expression when rendered from the front by the photographer's lens. In two following pictures, Featherman appears first in profile, wearing the same simple shirt, and you see his elbow over the right elbow over the back of the chair, and then transitions into more of his show costume in a final full-length image, standing with his hand posed on the back of a chair and holding a paper fan in front of a studio backdrop. William, or Billy Peano, a close reading of whose portrait will serve as the primary focus of my paper today, while bringing in other comparative material and background about the album, presents himself with a straight expression and dons a mix of regalia and souvenirs from home, associated with the show, and acquired in Paris. And here's the profile view. Kill's enemy, Featherman, and Peano were just three of the approximately 100 American Indians who traveled with Buffalo Bill's Wild West's second European tour that began in Paris in 1889. As is well established, most of these native individuals were Lakota, and specifically Oglala, recruited by Cody from the Pine Ridge Agency, although some also came from neighboring Lakota agencies, such as Rosebud as well. And this has also been confirmed on my work in these albums in which I've located a lot of the sitters in period census records and allotment records that were done on the Pine Ridge reservation during this period. And I'll talk more about that later in the talk. The particular format of photographic image making employed by Bonaparte, the regularized picturing of each sitter from the front and then side in sequence, relates directly to the discursive arena in which he worked. Bonaparte was active in Parisian anthropological circles and société savante culture, or learned society culture. And the approach visualizes period conceptions of identity as bodily inherent, immutable, and grounded in the notion of the racial type, so here the American Indian type. While the surrounding compositional frame may have been intended to fix the subject, however, the range of objects and adornment showcased by Peano both traces and proudly displays elements of his transcultural experiences as a performer abroad. And by transcultural here, I'm referring to a term that's often used in cultural studies and post-colonial studies about two cultures in contact, often in kind of asymmetrical power relationships in which the more subjugated culture borrows and adapts from the dominant culture. So here, a bow and arrow and an Indian police star, a souvenir fan and a pendant from the Eiffel Tower, and the police star and the bow and arrow are from the show, all kind of layered in the picture on top of a beaded Lakota vest, might be read as coexisting to form a multivalent portrait suggestive of the way that Peano made the experience of show member his own and presents it here publicly. Returning now to the making of these works, Bonaparte was a frequent visitor to Buffalo Bill's Wild West during the troop's stay in Paris in 1889. And his photographic series follows dictates specific to the intellectual milieu in which he operated. He was elected membership to the Société d'Anthropologie de Paris, or the Paris Anthropology Society, in 1884, and trained in the École d'Anthropologie of Paul Broca, a private school for dispensing the emerging discipline's skills and knowledge. The study of human difference in France was rooted in physical anthropology and developed around the scrutiny of collections and visiting peoples in Europe rather than travel for a period of ethnographic immersion. Broca, who founded the Société d'Anthropologie in 1859, focused on the amassing and comparison of anatomical material and the classification of quote-unquote races, and advocated specifically for the use of photography in anthropological collections. Bonaparte derived his approach to photography from this framework and began using the medium in the early 1880s to picture visiting peoples in Europe, and especially Parisian exhibitions, such as a group of Omaha he photographed at the Jardin d'Acclimatation in 1883, and then compiled these pictures into groups of albums, multiple album sets, in 1884, which he entitled Peau Rouge, or in English, Redskins. He followed Broca's directive regarding the camera image that the sitter's exposed face should always be frontally represented, or the head should be exactly in profile, as, quote, the other points of view have no utility, end quote. Given Broca's methodology, the 1889 exposition appeared as an ideal opportunity to encounter numerous diverse cultures, and he frequented not only the ethnographic villages in the colonial section, but also the Wild West encampment and arena in Noilly during the 6-month run of the fair. And this is the map from the Wild West's visit to Paris in 1889, and you see that the Indian encampment specifically are right here. Newspaper accounts note Bonaparte's attendance at social events on the Wild West grounds, and between August 19th and 27th, an international congress of anthropology and prehistoric archaeology was also held in Paris. On this occasion, members of the Société d'Anthropologie visited native performers of the troupe with the attendees, and perhaps it was at this time that Bonaparte's series was made. Just as the categorization of peoples in anthropological discourse created a hierarchy between the imagined alignment of physical attributes and psychic capacities of extra-European peoples, popular responses to the Wild West interpreted the display through the lens of French imperialism, both past and present, and the notions of culture and civilization that supported it. First, the inclusion of French Canadian trappers in the troupe, added specifically for the Parisian version of the show, alluded directly to France's former and waning empire in North America. These figures, two of whom Bonaparte photographed, and one of these sitters you see here, as well as the Lakota performers, from among the plains cultures to which the French had become connected over the course of the 17th century through trade networks and relationships such as intermarriage, all recalled long histories of presence and exchange in this part of the continent. Such relationships are particularly pertinent for Bonaparte's project, as his own great uncle, Napoleon I, sold the vast Louisiana territory to the US in 1803, extinguishing the dream of a sustained French empire in North America. Second, although not immediately involving the French in the imaginary geography the show conjured, the Wild West also affirmed the host nation's rationale for conquest in its notions of competing levels of cultural development. The author of an article in L'Illustration on May 25th, for example, praises Buffalo Bill's shooting and horsemanship, terming him, quote, the Napoleon of the prairie, end quote, as we just heard from Emily as well. Numerous other journalistic accounts also conflate descriptions of the native members of the Wild West with those performers in live displays in the colonial section, France's own colonial subjects. Although the creation of this photographic series was linked to these discourses of fixing and a larger cultural reception of imperialism, a fluidity in categories of definition characterizes the album set, with the pictures perhaps interpreted on the continuum between studies and portraits, even in the maker's own time. Whereas Bonaparte's other compilations of sitters made at exhibitions earlier in the decade, such as the pictures of the Omaha that I showed earlier, were produced in multiples as part of his Collection Anthropologique and disseminated, this body of work is unique. Filling three oversized leather-bound tomes, the pictures also do not contain any of the classificatory markings or labels around the photographs in the manner of his earlier series. Inside the books, the viewer experiences one photograph pasted on each recto. So you open the book and you see this photograph, the frontal photograph, on a single blank sheet. You turn the page, and then you see a profile photograph with none of kind of the insignia or markings that you saw on the pictures of the Omaha sitters made earlier. And complicating the anthropological format of the pictures, the frame, Bonaparte has included not just the native performers in the series, although they comprise 113 out of the total 148 pictures, but the litany of characters in the troupe, so the vaqueros, the cowboys, the cowgirls are also pictured. The books, in fact, commence with Cody himself, who initially appears in a frontal view, cowboy hat tilted on his head, looking straight into the camera. In a following profile image, he has removed his hat, kept his left elbow on the back of the chair, and turned his face, but not his body, to the side. This partial playing along with the parameters of the project, complicates the racialized intentions of the format and points to the limitations of the intellectual framework and mode of image making in which Bonaparte worked. The pictures of Cody also suggest the greater process of exchange that occurred during the photographic process, in that the maker, the author, might have brought their own intentions, but the level of compliance or participation of the sitter was up to them. And the larger albums themselves as objects, in which Peano appears in the third book, contain evidence of these encounters. So a list of names and other details related to the sitters corresponds with each of the three volumes. These lists serve as an invaluable resource and starting point for making archival interventions with the individual prints, but also suggest the types of exchanges that took place on the encampment grounds, where the pictures appear to have been created. So full of spelling and other errors, they indicate the degree to which information was lost, misunderstood, or reimagined as two cultural groups came together, often with a translator or mediator in between. So Bonaparte, or whomever he had documenting the names, for example, has, as you see here, so many of you who kind of work on these Lakota performers might recognize some of these names, but see the errors. So Rocky Bear is Racky Bone here. Dog's Ghost, you see missing an H. Black Fox, who's Joe Black Fox, is Black Foy, and Michelle, we communicated about this. Red Shirt, you see, has an E. Featherman is father, man. So you see sort of all of these mistakes. And then in the third book, where Peano appears as the first sitter, he's just added an S up here. So these exchanges most likely happened quickly and orally, and the spelling out of names was therefore phonetic, with the differences of the parties being cultural as well as linguistic, of course, along with many other things. So to clarify my research process, I worked on these names first with the master list of performers by year held here at the center with the help of Mary Robinson and Kathleen Broder. And then I also worked on them with an elder and genealogist at Pine Ridge at the Oglala Lakota College Archives, with an 1890 census done at Pine Ridge and an allotment roll done between 1904, taken between 1904 and 1906. And so that's how I was able to find many of the correct names, but it's, you know, always a process, ongoing process, but we found many of them. So the photographs were results of such intercultural, and that was Stella Ironcloud, I should say, and I want to acknowledge and thank her for her help on my research. So the photographs were a result of such intercultural encounters. And Bonaparte worked by erecting a makeshift studio on exhibition grounds, making pictures himself and working with outside photographers, acting as a producer. With the sitter bringing their own intentions and choices of self-presentation to the process, even if limited, they should be interpreted to at least some extent as co-author in the resulting work. In these exchanges, one of the central aspects of the featured subject's presentation that problematizes the anthropological intent of the photographic approach are the references to performance that appear inside the frame to varying degrees throughout the series, such as the prop from the Wild West that Peano holds here, a bow and arrow at the bottom of the frame. Some of the sitters in the body of work do not wear any of their show costumes, only pictured in simple cloth shirts, such as Featherman, who I showed at the beginning, or showcase just a few flourishes from it, like a scarf or a vest. And this group of photographs is highly unusual for the period in this way, and in only relatively few instances do we see a full native show costume. And you can think about how unusual this is if you know the Gertrude Kazebier series made about 10 years later and how different that is, these pictures are than that in this way. The pictures that display objects from the arena, however, clearly reference the work of performance and the sitter's public and self-conscious enactment of an indigenous identity with the show. Peano clutches a bow and arrow with his left hand and the feather of the arrow, with the feather of the arrow coming just to the edge of the right of the frame, as I showed you here. Jimmy Nelson, a younger troop member in his mid-teens on this tour, sits in the space of the constructed studio, holding a bow and arrow as well, the only other sitter in the series to exhibit this prop. He pulls back the arrow tautly in his right hand, the tip nestled between the fingers of his left, as though ready to shoot. The appearance of individuals inside the bounds of the picture frame, posing with objects, complicates the attempt to pin them down based on fixed, inherent notions of bodily identity. These individuals were paid performers who enacted Cody's version of Western history before vast Parisian audiences, playing to expectations for personal and cultural necessity. Peano also wears a silver star here, indicating another aspect of his professional involvement with the show. The badge identifies him as a member of the Indian Police, comprised of a select group of indigenous men who kept order among the native troop members and in their encampment. As a number of scholars have noted since the mid-1990s, such work as a performer with the Wild West provided means of both economic and cultural survival for the Lakota in the early reservation period. Evident from show contracts of the period, Lakota men employed with the Wild West at this time made between $25 and $75 per month, with most of them earning the former. And women who traveled with their husbands averaged about $10 a month. This work served as a necessary source of income, especially during the late 1880s and early 1890s, when show performers, 1890s, when show performers secured higher and much needed wages than those who stayed on the reservation, where since 1868, with the Fort Laramie Treaty, the Lakota had been forced to depend on government provisions and rations, which were being reduced at this time. So the census and allotment records I located for the sitters in the Bonaparte albums done on Pine Ridge in 1890 and between 1904 and 06 confirm this necessity. These men in almost all cases are listed as the head of the household or in a few instances, the eldest son in the recorded family group. Peano, in his mid-20s in 1889, is recorded as 37 and the head of the household in the 1904 allotment roll. Married to a woman named Annie, and with three daughters, Rose, 8, Hilda, 6, Delilah, 5, and a son unnamed, 2.5. This pattern overwhelmingly repeats itself. These individuals were fathers and husbands and had dependents who relied on them in a drastically altered economy and cultural system in which to provide. Well, Peano's bow and arrow, an Indian police star, communicate his role as a performer. His beaded vest displays his Lakota cultural identity and suggests elements of its adaptability and transformation in situations of duress and cross-cultural contact. As numerous specialists in Plains art have indicated, beadwork flourished in the early reservation period among the Lakota, with women introducing new materials and designs to their productions. Smaller glass European seed beads replaced earlier, larger options through trade networks on the plains by the mid-19th century, and Lakota women created a style in which they covered entire objects in beads. One such piece was the man's vest of Euro-American fashion, either acquired in cloth as an annuity good or constructed from cowhide in place of buffalo and then beaded. Newly incorporated into the designs were pictorial motifs such as the Eagle Thunderbird on the top portion of Peano vests and the American flag in the lower section, which became particularly common decorative elements in this period. Wild West performers particularly favored these vests, and costume played an important role during auditions for the participation. When actually traveling with this show, such regalia proclaimed troop members' Lakota identity publicly to vast audiences internationally. The souvenir fan held by Peano and the round pendant affixed to his vest below the Indian police star trace and proudly display another role facilitated by employment with the Wild West, that of traveler and tourist abroad. As opposed to the control and surveillance instituted by reservation life, Philip DeLoria writes that, quote, in the midst of this fixity, the Wild West promised extraordinary mobility, end quote. Remnants of this mobility in the form of traversal through the city and fare as visitors to Paris remain in some of Bonaparte's photographs, such as this, in the form of objects and ephemera acquired in Paris. Major John M. Burke, general manager and chief press agent of the Wild West, arranged sightseeing tours for the troop, and numerous press articles follow the movement of the native performers in their various itineraries. Likely the most reported on of these visits was that made to the top of the Eiffel Tower. Newspapers detail two trips taken very close together by groups of the Lakota on August 9th and August 13th. Some of the articles juxtapose descriptions of cultural primitivism associated with the native visitors with those of technological advancement and exhilaration for the tower. Other texts, however, highlight the celebrity of these about 40 members of the Wild West troop who ascended. Le Figaro reads, for example, quote, "By 9 o'clock, they were all on the third platform, admiring with exclamations of surprise and grand gestures the panorama of the environs of Paris. In coming back down, they were keen to visit us and together invaded our small pavilion, where the public pressed to see them," end quote. Le Figaro details that after descending, the performers wanted their names printed in the journal. So Major Burke recorded all of them, and the list follows in the text, with a similar series appearing after the second visit 4 days later. One of the names listed in Le Figaro from August 9th, the August 9th visit, is Billy Pino, corresponding with William or Billy Piano, as we found in the allotment roll records, who appears in the albums decorated with traces of this touristic encounter with the Eiffel Tower. These vestiges of his visit to the central Parisian monument at the 1889 fair include, in the frontal image, a paper fan, so this here, displayed at a tilt in his right hand. The object pictures a female figure, hand on her hip, and across the curving top of the piece, the words "Souvenir de la Tour Eiffel 1889" unfold. Payana also wears a pendant right below his gleaming silver Indian police star. So this right here. The pendant reads, "Souvenir of my ascension to the third floor of the Eiffel Tower, 1889. These commemorative medals, which could be purchased exclusively at the Eiffel Tower, were envisioned and designed by M. Duperron, director of the metallurgic factory of Paris. Bronze on the first floor, silver on the second floor, and gold on the third, the pendants were sold on their respective platforms for the price of 1 franc, where the buyers had their names engraved into the cartouche and the exact day of their journey put around the year." So you see, I found this on eBay, but so I don't know who acquired it exactly, but someone's name, well, we can see the name, but the name when you bought it was put here, and then the exact day, so 3rd November 1889. So Payano would have had the same thing on his. Such a purchase would allow one, after returning home from their experience, as Le Figaro described, to show, quote, "You know, I climbed it, that is, for more people than you think, the important point, the true triumph," end quote. Payano himself wears the object in this way, echoed by this display of the fan, publicly announcing that he himself climbed it and has claimed the most contemporary of experiences at the 1889 fair. To conclude, Payano's self-presentation and mix of regalia here suggests different aspects of his identity and experiences, coalescing to form a multivalent portrait that disrupts the associations and intentions of Bonaparte's framing photographic approach. His display of a souvenir fan while clutching a bow and arrow from the show and donning a beaded vest adorned with Eiffel Tower pendant and Indian police star convey his status as a modern urban traveler and Lakota performer simultaneously. The layering of these bodily decorations and objects in the work publicly communicates elements of his accomplishments and identity, just as a regalia had long played a fundamental social role for Lakota men in proclaiming achievements and maintaining status in the pre-reservation period. Thank you.
Can we have a light up here? So you guys want to come up here and then come to the mic? We have time for one really long question or two short ones. Karen in the back.
All right, Question is for the two Emilies. I'm wondering about the use and dissemination of the photographs, Emily, beyond their use in the anthropological albums. Do we know if French artists, Emily Burns, were looking at these photographs for source material for paintings as they looked to depict the American West? And also, Emily, did the American Indian sitters ever request prints of the photographs for their own use?
So I work on the Omaha series I showed. I also work on, I work on those pictures too, and I've worked with the Omaha tribal historians on those pictures quite a bit. And there are some period, like late 19th century prints in the community with like, you know, some markings on them and things that suggest to me they were given at the exhibition. There is a set of these pictures that I showed at the Oglala Lakota College archives, but they are later prints. I don't know if any of the sitters were given prints, but based on the Omaha having these prints in their community from the period, and like what I know about some delegation portraiture too, it is possible that they were given pictures. And this particular series wasn't disseminated, as far as I've seen anywhere, but Bonaparte's other series were disseminated, like the Omaha pictures are in multiple collections. And so I'm not sure that artists were looking at them, but Emily can talk about how like Rosa Bonheur and some of the painters were looking at other Western photographers, like William Henry Jackson, and in their work. Yeah.
So Karen, just to make sure I understood your question, it's that the question is whether or not French artists were looking at photography related to Buffalo Bill's Wild West in their art. Thank you. I would say some of it is Buffalo Bill's Wild West photography, but also other visual culture that circulated with the show that became the source for pictures. For example, there's a couple of images that were posters that were cribbed from Remington that worked their way into the French mass media, more than into kind of high art production. Although that said, there is a sculpture by Isidore Bonheur, the brother of Rosa Bonheur, depicting a buffalo hunt that was made before Buffalo Bill's Wild West tour in Paris. And so I don't know, but it seems engaged with a lot of that visual rhetoric, and so I sort of wonder if maybe he went to the London display. And then the last comment I'll make about that is that in the background of that Rough Rider cover that I showed with Cody in the foreground, the figure in the background of an American Indian with a war bonnet, I think is taken pretty closely out of the Bonheur picture of Red Shirt and Rocky Bear that you have here in the gallery. And so I think there is a sense in which there's an overlapping visual resource that is circulating around the show that artists are freely drawing on. Thank you.
My name is Didier Gondola from Indiana University. I have a couple of questions for the two Emilies as well. To the first Emily, a comment first. I've come across, after Buffalo Bill left, a young French children actually reenacting the Wild West show in the Bois de Boulogne, which is not far from Neuilly, where the show was taking place. And, you know, since you mentioned the Franco-Prussian War and the defeat, and in my work, I have also seen that the French explorers, you know, kind of the antidote to the defeat was, you know, to make forays into Central Africa, West Africa, and those French explorers were pretty much celebrated because they kind of embodied this kind of virility that the French were looking for. Did you come across kind of images depicting those French explorers and Buffalo Bill side by side? And then to the second Emily, you know, since Bonaparte was part of the Société d'Anthropologie founded by Paul Broca, I was wondering if he collected also or made pictures of some of those African colonial subjects that were in France, because I think that kind of behind the project was also sort of racial hierarchy that that Broca and some of his disciples were trying to create?
Thank you for your question. To answer the first part of your question, there is a tremendous practice that happens after 1889 in particular, but again in 1905-06 in terms of people playing Indian and kids in particular. There's even a cartoon from the press in 1905 of a little boy who has been playing Indian and an errant arrow somehow collected his baby sibling in the baby blanket and brought him up into a tree. So there is certainly that kind of practice, and the people who published the biography of Vincent van Gogh a few years ago included a theory in the footnote that van Gogh may have been killed by accidental shot from kids playing Buffalo Bill's Wild West. And we can talk about that later. But in terms of your other question, that would be, that's not within the purview of the research that I've done, but that would be a fascinating question to pursue. I have spent a lot of time looking at the ways in which the discourse about the French reception to American Indians parallels ideas about French colonial subjects as a way to show that they brought that lens to looking at Wild West performers. But I wouldn't be surprised to find that kind of cowboy character appearing in the many illustrated articles about French colonial forays. So that sounds like a wonderful possible future project. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Yes, he did photograph France's own colonial subjects from Africa. I'm sure, based on what you're asking, that you're aware of the exhibition histories at the Jardin d'Acclimatation. He photographed extensively there in the 1880s, which is something we can talk more about later if you'd like to, as far as his photographic practice and where those photographs are, if you're interested in that. And he also photographed at the Exposition Universelle many of the different groups in 1889. And so he was incredibly prolific in amassing this material, and throughout the 1880s, disseminating it in a scientific gifting culture.